Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā kāra katoa. Good afternoon, everybody. Very warm welcome to SoulFood with me, Rev. Welcome to this Thursday session of SoulFood as we gather on day 42 of this lockdown process. Kia kaha, sorry, day 43. This is the question I get asked a lot, and I've been asked this question a lot in the last few weeks. Where is God? Where is God in all of this? So I would like to talk about that little bit today and perhaps throw some questions out there for us to think about as well. Where is God? Let us begin with these opening responses. The Lord be with you. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. So let us pray. Lord, it is day 43 and we're in lockdown. Level 4 is behind us. Level 2, as we will discern and discover soon, is a very real possibility. But Lord, this has been hard for so many people in so many different ways, in our community, in our nation, and certainly around the world. So let us be still in the middle of this day in your divine, loving, healing presence. Let us pray for those who've been really deeply affected by COVID-19. Let us too pray for ourselves and for one another. Lord, it's day 43 and the world is moving. There is motion, there is noise, there is movement of people. But let us not forget all that has passed. So let the quietness of these few minutes enable us to hear your still small voice to us. Let us too pray that at the end of this, that we can look forward to new joys and new possibilities, new days, all shaped by what has come before us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're going to swap things around a bit today, so we don't become creatures of habit. We're going to sing our waiata now, and then we're going to have our little piece of music, our reflection music, after I finish my little talk today. Okay, so we're going to have a waiata, the Lord of the Dance. Take it away, Mr. Carpenter. Thank you.
I danced in the morning when the world was begun, and I danced with the moon and the stars and the sun. Came up from heaven and I danced on the earth. At Bethlehem I had my birth. Dance there, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dancing. I danced on the Sabbath and I killed my name for whole people. So it was a shame. They whipped and they stripped and they hung me up. They left me there on a cross to die. Dance then wherever you may be. I am the man of the dance I be, and I lead you all wherever. They cut me down and I let them fall. I'm the life that will never, never die. I'll leave you with you, I'm the Lord of the dark side. Dance there, wherever you may be. I am the man of the dancing, and
Fantastic. Thank you, Mr. Carpenter. And well done for your singing today, guys. I could hear you from here. Today's Bible reading, it comes from one of the letters of St. John. And really, God? Question mark. Where there is love, then there is God. St. John wrote these words. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. And so we've come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and whoever abides in love, i.e. dwells within, whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in them. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Here ends the reading. Thanks be to God. So there's a question here that is asked. Where is God? We ask this question a lot. We've asked this question for thousands of years. We've asked this question every time when disaster strikes, when there is war, when there is violence, where there is pestilence and plague and famine, where there is disaster, when there is cyclone, when there is a virus engulfing the world, where there is climate change. Whenever there is something that confronts us and confronts our vulnerability as human beings, regardless of the source, we say things like, where is God? And of course, if we don't find a sufficient answer to that question, we abandon the idea and the notion of God. It entirely happens repeatedly. It's happened generation after generation after generation. If we can't discern God at work somewhere, if we're looking for a scapegoat and somebody to blame, we say, well, what's God up to? What's God doing about this? The question we asked. This, I think, quite powerful story, first told by Hans Christian Andersen many, many centuries ago, is called The Two Mirrors. And I think it sort of addresses this question in part for us in quite an important way. And it's a story. So the characters are, of course, in this story, God and Satan. It goes like this: the devil, Satan, took great pleasure, does take great pleasure in causing and creating confusion. And to help him do this better, one day he had a special kind of mirror made. And of course, this mirror would shrink the reflection of all the good and the beautiful things in the world and in people, and it would enlarge the bad and the ugly thing. The mirror distorted life for people. Satan took great pleasure in going around the earth, holding this mirror up to people, up until their eyes, until there was not a single land or a single person who had not seen this distorted view of the world, the enlarged stuff that was bad and ugly, and the shrunken, shriveled, good and beautiful. One day, Satan was laughing so hard at the misery and suffering he'd caused by this mirror that it slipped from his hand and his grip, and it shattered into thousands and millions of fragments. A great storm blew up and carried these fragments and spread them all around the world to every single corner of the globe. The fragments were as small as grains of sand. They lodged in people's eyes. And from then on, people could only see the bad things in the world. Other fragments were gathered up over the years and centuries, and they were made into glasses, and people wore these glasses so that they too could never see anything in its proper perspective again. All they could see was the bad and the ugly. God was sad when he saw how damaged people's vision had become, how many of them could only see the bad and the ugly around them. They couldn't see anything good and beautiful anymore. And so he came up with this idea. I know what I do, God thought to himself. My son is the image of me. He is my true reflection. I'll send him into the world to reflect my goodness and my justice and show the world how I long for it to be. Jesus became a mirror for God's people, reflecting God's goodness out into the world, even to thieves and frauds and those whom the world despised. He reflected courage and confidence into the heart of the sick and the despairing. He reflected comfort into those who were grieving, trust to those whose hearts were crippled by fear. People recognized God's mirror. They followed Jesus. They loved. They trusted Jesus. Others soon became jealous. They felt their own power threatened by God's love. And so in the end, they can tolerate this mirror no longer, this Jesus. And so they plotted, they killed him. They shattered God's mirror. Again, a great storm blew up, blew the millions of the fragments of God's mirror into every corner of the world. And it continues to do this today. These fragments lodge in the eyes of many people. And however this happens, they see God's world again. Just as Jesus saw it, they see the beauty and the goodness of God's creation, the beauty and the goodness in all people. It's a great story. A great story. It's an old story. Hans Christian Andersen was writing a couple of centuries ago. It's a great story in response to this question, where is God? Where is God in places of suffering? We've asked it since we first kind of developed any kind of doctrine or theology around this idea of a divine, supreme being or intelligence, a creator. What's going on in creation when it's broken with the creator? What's happening with this? And so we interpret that into this question, where is God? Where is God in all of this, in all of this pain, and all of this suffering? Bible tells us that God is love. So we connect that question with that statement. Where is God in all of this? God is love becomes the bridge. Where is love in all of this? One of the worst plagues to hit the world, probably forgotten plague, almost as bad as the Black Death of the 13th century, and certainly worse than the Great Plague of the 17th century, was the plague of Cyprian. It hit the world, the most of Europe, the Roman Empire particularly, in the year 249 AD or CE. It lasted for 13 years, sporadically, 13 years of plague. It was known as the plague of Cyprian because it was named after Saint Cyprian of Carthage. He was a bishop, a Christian. This plague killed 5,000 people a day in the city of Rome alone. 5,000 people a day. It lasted on and off for 13 years. It almost caused the premature downfall of the Roman Empire. One of the reasons why Christianity became so successful and was growing quite significantly at this time, just a couple of hundred years after the time of Jesus, because people noticed something in Christians. They noticed they didn't flee for the hills. They noticed that they stayed behind. They stayed with the people dying of plague. They put their own lives at risk because of the love they had for other people, the love that had been expressed to them through God and in Jesus Christ. Their faith, their love, the love of God inspired them and drove them into places where everybody else was fleeing from. The plague of Cyprian was one of the things that Richie galvanized the church into action. Christians stayed because they cared, because they loved, because they believed in that love. They are expressing truly what God was as expressed in Jesus Christ. So wherever we find love at work, we find God. We find life, as you can see on the screen, that quote from Mahatma Gandhi. Love is present and the actions and the kindness and all the things that are going on in the world right now. There is so much love around. Random acts of kindness, compassion, people caring for others in need, beyond their bubbles, beyond their own immediate families, just like they have for thousands of years. Where will we find that? Where we discern the love and the compassion of people, that's the place to look for God. Not up there, but in here. That's where you'll find God at work through the lives of people who express that love. What is love? Love is patient and kind. It's not envious or boastful, not arrogant or rude. It doesn't insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. It doesn't rejoice at wrongdoing. It bears, believes, hopes, endures all things. St. Paul wrote that 2,000 years ago. Love is patient, love is kind. We're going to need a lot of love and patience and kindness in the next few weeks and months as we move into level two. And I'll probably say a bit more about that as well as we move into that place. We're going to need to be loving and patient and kind people for this to work and to work well. So let's think about that question. Where is the love? Let us pray a simple prayer. Thank you for love. Help us to love. And bless those who love us today. And may the God of love be with all those who feel that they have no one to love them today. In Jesus' name. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Couple of short notices. Don't forget today's body food after school. Also, Komodo Day as well, Thursday. Fill out your apps as they come in on your inbox. And a big happy birthday today for all those from today until next Monday across the school community. We've got Ben, Diesel, Tom, Zoe, Hamish, Kobe, Jackson, Joshua, Anton, Ben, Ned. Happy birthday to you. Have a great day today and over the next few days until Tuesday's Soul Food. Sunday, 11 o'clock, I'll be here for the Communion Soul Food for those who want to join in. Kia kaha, New Zealand. Have a great day. Thanks for tuning into Soul Food, and may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and be upon those whom you love this day and always. Amen. And together we say the words of St. Paul's grace, and today in English. Ki tau ki tata katoa, te atawhai te tata ariki, a ihu karaiti. Me te aratoa te atoa, me te whiwhina taitanga ki te waruru tapu, ake, 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 amen. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all forever and ever. Amen. Go in the love of God, the peace of Christ, the dignity of the Holy Spirit. Kia kaha, kia hari, kia tapu. Be strong, be happy, be holy. Amen.